severely inhibited by rifampicin and rosuvastatin. Methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus has shown significant inhibition from this dye at much smaller doses than 10 parts per million. So has Bacillus thuringiensis. It is being investigated as a potential insecticide. However, spores are typically more resistant to pesticides. They're resistant to heat, and according to the literature, have also been resistant to photoactivated dyes. What we have seen in this research is the vegetative thuringiensis did seem to have was inhibited by the 10 parts per million rifampicin rosuvastatin. Spores, which typically should not have been inhibited by rifampicin and rosuvastatin, did show some inhibition as well. Staph aureus showed some muted inhibition, but not typically what has been seen in the past. The gram-negative strains, Pseudomonas and E. coli, behaved as expected. There was no effect. There even seemed to be some synergistic response from the oxygen created when light activation occurred. The most effective minimum inhibitory concentration was 10 parts per million. There was significant interaction seen at 1 hour, but primarily at 8 hours. Some potential reasons for this is that as you increase the dye dosage, it is going to increase the concentration. It is going to scatter light more. So the effect of the dose versus the effect of the dye is going to be less able to statistically isolate. There was, however, no significant variation between the responses to the dyes. Fluoxetine was no better, no worse than rosuvastatin. They both seem to have an inhibitory effect specifically on the Bacillus thuringiensis. What we can take from this research is several avenues of interest either at Jackson State or at other universities. Maybe we need to look at the different stages of growth. I investigated the stationary phase of growth bacteria, membrane, cellular structures such as lipids and protein are known to vary between stages of growth, whether it be the initial phase, the long phase of growth, or the stationary phase. This may affect the membrane interaction of the dye. There's been some promising research with the use of concomitant therapy of fluoxetine with traditional antibiotics. So maybe we cannot develop new therapies yet for resistant bacteria. However, we can incorporate these dyes with present antibiotics, hopefully give us a window time frame so that they can be created. This has been seen with Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Now, I told you about the four classes of dyes. We looked at phenothiazine. However, the positively charged dyes, I think it's the thylacinates, have shown a great response to gram-negative bacteria. These polycationic dyes can be conjugated to traditional antibiotics, causing a specific target for Pseudomonas. And this was seen in a study where Pseudomonas was in a wound with Staph aureus. The antibiotics specifically targeted Pseudomonas greater than the traditional antibiotic alone and even left Staph aureus isolated. It did not have an effect on Staph aureus. Gram-negative expansion can be used with fluoxetine. There has been some research if you create a positively charged conjugate to fluoxetine, it can target gram-negatives as well. This is ideal since fluoxetine has been approved for use in human consumption and human contact. Regarding the use of fluoxetine as a treatment in the environment, want to be careful with use of Flotsam bee because it seems to target some ideal bacteria such as Bacillus thuringiensis. However, due to its localization, its rapid biodegradable capabilities, if you were to use it as a therapy on fields, most likely it would not affect spore growth. This would leave the spores of the bacteria, they could vegetate and still cause their pathogenic response to insects, yeast, bacteria that typically target our crops. And finally, to leave aquaculture once and for all, this is where I started. Floxamine is still an ideal therapeutic against aquaculture industry. They experience typically, specifically the packaging industry, 55% loss of fry due to different enterobacteria, parasites, and so forth. It is an ideal therapy for the setting to incorporate into water or into feed, activate with light. I would like to thank my committee chair, Dr. Blair, for all his help in the lab, helping me pick a new project, develop it. I would like to thank my committee members, Dr. Mark Mead and Dr. Hamasu, for helping me with the stats and encouragement. I need to give a special thanks to Dr. Richardson and Dr. Todd Durham. I met them, they were my professors from my pharmacy program, and they work at PharmaLink, which is a professional CRO for all. And since they are professional statisticians, they were very gracious, stayed with me after class until 10 o'clock at night, going over these statistics and trying to explain to me what my data and interactions and so forth meant. Thank the Jackson State Biology Departments and Dr. Devereaux for the provision of spores, spores and protocols, my family, all of the Jacksonville State graduate students that I've known over these years. And a special thank you to Richard Watkins. One final thank you before I go. He has been with me in the lab late at night, working on his own material. He is going to be an expert in this field if he's not already, and provided me some methods for completing my research and video aids and just general all-around great help.